फाइन सर।
ओके We'll just wait for one or two more minutes because some people are still joining. I'm sorry, I don't have it. Saptarshi, were you able to do it?
Sir, all the lectures are uploaded in YouTube.
Oh, in YouTube, is it?
Yes, sir. I sent the link.
Okay, okay. So, yeah, whoever doesn't have it, maybe you can put it on the chat box here also. Is there a channel? Okay. Do you have a channel or?
Yes, the channel name is the password, but I don't think it appears in the password, but I will share the link.
Okay, fine. Okay, thanks. Yeah, I'm using the microphone, so I'm sitting a little bit far from the laptop. Okay, so if somebody cannot hear, please let me know. Then I will switch back to the laptop. Okay. So we were looking at a lattice which can vibrate. Okay. So in the first unit, sort of, we had looked at crystallography. And in crystallography, the basic idea is that, okay, somebody else has joined. Okay. Yeah. So in crystallography, the idea is that atoms are placed in periodic positions. So it's a periodic lattice. And the main thing is that it is a rigid lattice. Okay. So which means that the atoms are not moving about their equilibrium positions. Okay. Now the next thing that can happen to this periodic lattice is that the atoms can start oscillating about their equilibrium positions. Now, when we say oscillating, that is itself a very important word here. Okay, let me dwell a little bit on this word oscillations. So when we mean oscillation, it means that when an atom moves away from its equilibrium position, there has to be a restoring force, which brings it back to the equilibrium position, right? So as soon as we say oscillation, we also mean that there has to be a restoring force, okay? And that restoring force acts in such a way that the atom always comes back to its equilibrium position. Whether the restoring force is of the form Kx or not, we don't know. Okay, whether it is harmonic or not, we don't know, but there has to be some restoring force. Now, we can ask the question, where does this restoring force come from? So this is basically related to bonding. So depending on the kind of bond you have, the strength of the bond determines the strength of the spring or the strength of the restoring force, right? So if it's a very strong bond, then the atoms will move about less or their frequency will be very high. Okay. So what we had done in the last class was we had looked at the Taylor's expansion as a mathematical tool for understanding how the harmonic approximation of a crystal comes about. Okay. So what we had done is we had said, let's say the interatomic potential has some form. Okay, so it has some form phi of ri minus rj, and these ris and rjs, so ri and rj are the instantaneous positions. Instantaneous positions of the nuclei. Okay, of the nuclei. So remember, there are electrons also in the system, and we will come back to the electrons also, because remember, the bonding is definitely a feature which is caused by electrons. okay? And if electrons were not there, there would be no bonding, right? So electrons are crucial in this whole picture. But for now, let's just ignore electrons and assume that we are given some interatomic potential. Okay, so this is a given feature. Where does it come from? We will come back to this question a bit later. But suppose we are given some interatomic potential, and the interatomic potential has a form Ri minus Rj, where Ri and Rj are the instantaneous positions of the nuclei at positions or indexed by positions I and j. Okay, so now what I can do is I can write Ri as some capital Ri plus a small ui. Okay, so this is like the equilibrium position. Okay, and this ui is the displacement from the equilibrium. Okay, so given this, what we can do is to take this phi of Ri minus Rj, okay, and then do a Taylor's expansion, right? So how do we do that? We substitute back this expression Ri plus Ui. So we will get at Ri minus Rj plus Ui minus Uj, okay? Now remember, Ri minus Rj, this is a vector which is like a crystal vector. Okay, so this is like a crystal vector, okay, which has dimensions of the order of the lattice parameters themselves. But what about the correction Ui minus Uj? Okay, this correction Ui minus Uj, remember, is the displacement from equilibrium of the atom at Ri. Right, and same thing for this. So the ui minus uj mod of ui minus uj can be expected to be much smaller than ri minus rj. Okay, so if this is the case, then this sort of an interatomic potential is amenable to a Taylor's expansion. Okay, and using this Taylor's expansion, we had shown the harmonic approximation for a system of coupled harmonic oscillators. Okay, so let's just revise that a little bit. Let me just clear this off. Okay, so what we are saying now is that the interatomic potential is of the form Ri minus Rj plus Ui minus Uj. Okay, and if you remember the Taylor's expansion form, then it will be of the form phi 0 Ri minus Rj, or let's say phi of Ri minus Rj plus the correction term Ui minus Uj dot the gradient of the phi of Ri minus Rj. But in this gradient term, you substitute the Ui and Uj to be 0. Okay, so this, remember, is calculated at equilibrium, because when the displacement from equilibrium is 0, then the interatomic potential or this gradient is calculated at equilibrium. Okay, so all the derivatives are calculated at equilibrium. That's very important to remember, right? And then the second term would be Ui minus Uj dot gradient whole squared of the phi Ri minus Rj, again calculated at Ui equal to 0, Uj equal to 0. Okay, so and then of course there are higher order terms which will look like Ui minus Uj dot grad whole cube and whole to the power 4 and so on. So those will be the enharmonic terms. Okay, why do we say this? Yeah,
I think this will be capital R, capital Ri, capital Rj in the right hand. Ri just the equation.
One second. Somebody's trying to join. Yes, go on. What is the question?
I think in the RHS of this equation, this will be capital Ri, capital Rj.
You mean here? These two you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, they will not be, because remember the Ri and Rj are the equilibrium positions. Okay. And in considering equilibrium positions, these are not dependent on the displacement from equilibrium. You understand? See, if I say that f of x plus a is f of a plus x times f dash of a, this is what you mean, right?
Yes.
Right? The problem is that this is understood to be equal to df by dx calculated at x is equal to or df by dx calculated at x is equal to a, right? Okay, so what I'm writing here is that the derivative has to be with respect to the variable. But once you calculate the derivative, wherever that variable is, you substitute the a. Okay, if you calculate the derivative itself with respect to the capital R's, you will not get the correct answer. So what I mean by that is that if you calculate df by da, that is not correct.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? Yeah, so that's basically the point, okay? Yeah, so Ri and Rj are the equilibrium positions, and what we mean is that you calculate the derivative in its full generality and then substitute the values of the equilibrium positions in the variables, okay? So that so this is basically the harmonic term. This linear term is an equilibrium term, which is zero. And it's zero because the gradient of the potential defines the forces, right? And the net force on the crystal would be zero in equilibrium. So if you are expanding about the equilibrium position, then you are at a minimum of the interatomic potential in terms of the crystal positions. And if you are at a minimum, then the slope has to be zero. Okay, so this term is zero and only the second term survives. And this term, if you see the one-dimensional form of this, you will get x squared d2 phi by dx squared, okay, calculated at x is equal to a. So this you can see has the form of the half kx squared, right? So if I define this particular quantity as half times the spring constant, then this term behaves like half kx squared. Remember, there is a half also. Sorry, I should have put that. So I don't need to use the half here. So this half is not there. And this is just k, okay? So the second derivative of the interatomic potential is the spring constant. And this entire term now behaves as half kx squared, right? So this is what will give you the harmonic term or the restoring force for the particular nuclei to come back to their equilibrium positions. In higher dimensions, it has to be generalized in this particular form. Now, this generalization has a very important implication. Okay, so the implication is that you can get combinations of these spring constants. The spring constant does not remain a scalar anymore. It actually becomes a tensor, right? Because the motion in x direction can influence the motion of the other atom in the x, y and z direction, right? So if you calculate this quantity, if you open up this quantity, right, then you can see that you will get del by del x, del by del y, del by del z, del by del x and so on, okay? So those mixed derivatives will also come in, and which means that you will get a matrix, right? You will actually get a second derivative matrix, and that second derivative matrix you have to diagonalize to get the principal axes. Right, but let's not go into those details. That detail might not be important for this course, but I just wanted to show you where does that restoring force come from. Okay, so this was just a review of the last class. Now let's go back to the question of where does this interatomic potential itself come from. Okay, so we have already assumed that there is some form of an interatomic potential. And this interatomic potential has a phi Ri minus Rj plus Ui minus Uj. And remember the first term in this, the phi of Ri minus Rj. Okay, this is what is used in crystallography. So because in crystallography, remember the Uis and Uj's are all zero, right? So we are only saying that the interatomic potential is dependent only on the equilibrium positions. So this is what is used for crystallography, right? All right, so where does this come from, right? And we have already discussed that this comes from bonding, So what this means is that suppose I want to solve the problem of a crystal, then I have to consider electrons plus the nuclei. Okay. Now, how come I'm able to treat purely the problem of nuclei as a standalone problem? Okay. So you remember what I had done in the previous class also is that I said that if I consider a crystal, then there is a kinetic energy of the nuclei and there is also the potential energy or the interatomic potential of the nuclei. Okay. So the question is, where are the electrons? Okay. What about the dynamics of the electrons? Why doesn't that matter? So what would be the answer for this? Why don't the electrons matter for considering the dynamics of a crystal? Any answers?
Is this because the energy scales are different?
Can you give me an example? What would be the energy scale of the nuclei and what would be the energy scale of the electrons? You are close, but not precise. So that is why I'm trying to make it more precise.
From crystals, by calculating these, we can get phonon modes.
So you're already considering the motion of the nuclei, right?
Yes,
and you're getting
yes,
the phonon
yes.
modes. Okay. And what would be the characteristic energy scale there?
There will be H cross omega.
Mm-hmm.
Which will be the phonon.
H cross omega. Okay. So what would be roughly that energy scale? So like a Debye scale, right?
Yes. Yes.
Good. Okay. Now what about electrons? So Akshay, I will come back to your question. I saw the question, okay? Okay, so let me give you the answer, right? So it's close that you're talking about separating the two energy scales, the energy scales which is characteristic of the nuclear problem and the energy scales characteristic of the electron problem. But rather than doing that, what would be more intuitive, right, is to look at the time scales of the motion of the electrons in the nuclei. The reason this is more intuitive and the electron, the energy scales is not intuitive is because, as you yourself said, you have to solve the problem of the nuclei, get the normal modes, and that would give you the characteristic energy scale, right? But without solving the problem, can we get an idea of the time scales in the problem? Okay, and that you can see that there is a separation of time scales that is happening in the problem. Remember, the nuclear masses, even a single proton, is 1800 times heavier than the electron. Okay, so that is itself an indication that there is something which can be separated between the electronic degrees of freedom and the nuclear degrees of freedom. Okay, or in other words, so what we could do is that we could write the electronic degrees of freedom as a separate Hamiltonian and the nuclear degrees of freedom as a separate Hamiltonian. So, and where does this come from? This comes from the fact that the time scales of motion of the electrons in the nuclei would be very different because their masses are extremely different. Okay, there are three to four orders of magnitude difference between the electronic motion and the nuclear motion, right? So that is what gives rise. So this particular fact gives rise to a certain kind of an approximation called the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. Okay, so most of you would have heard of this. So let's just go into a little bit of detail regarding the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. So let me give you a small example. This example is taken from Wikipedia, so you can also take a look at this. Let's imagine that we have the benzene molecule and you're trying to do a quantum chemistry calculation let's say, where in the quantum chemistry calculation you want to solve this problem keeping the nuclei and the electrons, but all the electrons, okay, including the hydrogen, the carbon and so on, okay, everything. So if I want to do that, then what should I do? How many degrees of freedom are there? Let's just count that, okay. So we see that the carbon has 6 electrons and the hydrogen has 1 electron, right? So the total electronic degrees, the total number of electrons in this system is 36 plus 6, which is 42, okay? And the nuclei, so there are 12 nuclei. So 6 carbon and 6 hydrogen, okay? So what we could do is that and remember, what we have to solve is really the Schrodinger's equation. Let's say we want to do the time independent Schrodinger's equation, right? Which means that we have to write down the kinetic energies of the nuclei. Okay, this is M, capital M. And this M, remember, includes both the carbon and the hydrogen, right? So carbon and hydrogen nuclei. Then you would have the electrons. So there are 42 electrons. I squared, okay, Ri, let's say. So this is the electronic kinetic energy. Then there would be a potential energy, there would be the this kind of a term, which is the potential between the electrons in the nuclei and, okay, somebody has a connectivity issue. Okay. So Krishna Kaniya, what we covered from the beginning was something that we did in the last class. So it was just a recapitulation. Okay, nothing new. We just recapitulated the Taylor's expansion, and I said that there is an interatomic potential that is given to us. The question is, where does this interatomic potential come from? Okay, so we said that if you consider a full crystal, then the bonding basically happens because of the electrons, right? So unless the electrons are present, you will not get bonds.
Okay.
So imagine, noble gases where the electrons are inert. So it's very difficult to crystallize that, right? Unless you introduce some kind of an interaction between the electrons and the nuclei, you cannot have bonding. Okay. So we are saying that there is there are electrons in the background which are giving you the interatomic potential, but what is happening to the dynamics of the electrons?
Yeah.
Why don't we consider that when considering the entire crystal? How can we consider the dynamics of the nuclei as a standalone problem? That is the question we are addressing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and to address this question, there is a particular approximation that is used called the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. Okay, and in this Born-Oppenheimer approximation, the dynamics of the nuclei and the dynamics of the electrons can be treated separately, independently. Okay, but I'll tell you how this is not completely independent. Okay, there is a certain degree of interdependence, which dependence comes from the electrons being dependent on the nuclear positions, but the nuclear positions do not depend on the electrons. Okay, so there is a one-way feedback, right? And that is what we are going to see. Okay, so that is basically the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. So for which I have taken the example of the benzene molecule, in which there are 6 carbon atoms and there are 6 hydrogen atoms. So total electrons are 42, total number of nuclei are 12, which means I have to write a full Schrodinger's equation. It's a partial differential equation in real space, which has kinetic energy terms. Okay, so there are 12 kinetic energy terms for the nuclei, 42 kinetic energy terms for the electrons. Then there is a interatomic potential, which is again, you take the combinations. So each electron interacts with every other nucleus, right? So like that, if you write the terms, and then you would also have the interatomic interactions. Okay.
Why are you considering only one hydrogen atom?
I did not. So there are, I'm sorry. I should have written here 6. Sorry. Yes.
Okay.
I was saying the number of electrons. So it turns out the carbon has 6 electrons, as well as there are 6 carbons. Hydrogen has only 1 electron, but there are 6 hydrogens. So there are six number of carbon, six number of hydrogen, but carbon has six electrons and hydrogen has one electron. That's all I was saying. Okay. Yeah, so what we are saying is that this potential and this potential here is not an effective potential. Okay. So remember, this is something that we said could be the Lennard Jones potential, but this is not what we are considering here. These are basically Coulomb potentials. Okay. So this and this are just the Coulomb potentials, the bare Coulomb potentials. And this is the multi-electron, multi-nuclei problem that quantum chemists have to solve in order to arrive at the full electronic structure and the nuclear structure of the benzene molecule, right? Now you can see that this is going to be a horrendously complicated problem. But what quantum chemistry scientists have been able to do is that they have been able to solve this entire equation as a partial differential equation, okay, coupled partial differential equation. Now in doing this, they have made one simplification. Okay, so that simplification is the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. So what is that approximation? It is just saying that the full wave function of the nuclei and of the electrons can be separated into two parts. Okay, the wave function of the nuclei and the wave function of the electrons. Now this separable form, okay, this is called a separable form, allows you to make certain simplifications to this particular Hamiltonian. Okay, now what that means is that if I want to consider purely the electronic part, okay, then what I will do is I will take the total wave function and I will split it into two parts, which is again the electronic part and the nuclear part. But remember, the electrons are actually interacting with the nuclei. Okay, so when I write down the H electronic part, I will write down the kinetic energy of the electrons. There is also one more term that I forgot to write, which is Ri minus Rj, that is inter-electron repulsion. Okay, so I will write down the kinetic energy of electrons. I will write the potential energy of the electrons themselves. And then there will be a term which is electron nuclei. Okay, now this is the term that is where this is the term for which the Born-Oppenheimer approximation applies. So what do I mean by this? See, remember, the electron nuclei term depends on the Ri, the positions of the nuclei. Okay, but these positions of the nuclei are also variables in the full Schrodinger's equation. However, in the electronic problem alone, if I want to solve the electronic problem alone, chi of Ri, what I can do is to assume that the Ri's are static. So I will assume that all the nuclei are sitting at fixed positions. These positions need not be the equilibrium positions. That is very important to understand. Okay, so assume that you have a perfect hexagon and all the carbon and the hydrogen are sitting at the ground state configuration. That is one possible configuration for the Ri's. Now you can move them. So let's distort the hexagon. You will get new capital Ri's. Okay, so what I mean is that you have to solve multiple number of electronic Schrodinger's equations where the H electronic, which has this electron nuclei, the nuclear positions keep on changing. Okay, so this will give you the E electronic Ri for a specific set of Ri. So which means you choose some molecular configuration and freeze it. Okay, once you freeze that nuclear configuration, that atomic the molecular configuration, then you solve the electronic problem, which means you solve the full Schrodinger's equation for the 42 electrons sitting in or experiencing the potential of the 12 nuclei which are not moving. Once you solve this problem, you will get some E electron. Okay, but this E electron, remember, depends on what choice you made for the Ri's. Next, what you can do is you can change the Ri positions by hand, manually, right? Manually, you say, let me choose a different configuration of the molecule. So maybe instead of this configuration, let's choose a slightly distorted configuration, okay? This kind of a configuration. So for this configuration, I again solve the H electronic problem. So this gives me one E electron, this gives me another E electron, and so on. So by doing this, I can get a full potential energy surface of the electrons, right, of this E electron surface in terms of the nuclear positions. Okay, and that potential is the effective potential that we had considered for the nuclei when we did the Taylor's expansion. Okay, see, this is the most important point. This is where the effective potential between the nuclei comes from. Remember, this potential is not the effective potential which is going into the full Schrodinger's equation. This is a pure Coulomb potential. What we have to do is that we have to consider the motion of the electrons, okay, to be much faster than the motion of the nuclei. In other words, we are saying when the nuclei move, the electrons immediately follow that configuration and equilibrate or find their new electronic configuration in that new nuclear configuration. Okay, so this is the essence of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, where we are saying that the electronic motion is decoupled from the nuclear motion, but only so far as the positions of the nuclei have to be given to us, right? And in this space of the nuclear positions, you can find out what are the electronic energies, and that set of electronic energies helps you to make a full potential energy surface. And in that potential energy surface, you find out the global minimum. That global minimum gives you the actual crystal structure. Okay, so when we had written this phi of Ri minus Rj, and we wrote the first term phi of capital Ri minus Rj, this is the global minimum of this potential energy surface. And this potential energy surface basically comes from the E electron of Ri. Okay, so the Born-Oppenheimer approximation is an extremely important approximation, which not only helps you to solve problems, but also helps you to do molecular dynamics. See, in when you know, you might have seen several talks where people talk about what is the configuration that DNA can take, okay, or what is the configuration that certain molecules can take. Or for example, when Professor Srikant Shastri studies, you know, glass formers, let's say he's studying water as a system or silicon as a system, and what are the different phases that it can take, then what they do is they want to know what are the interatomic potentials. Okay, and to get the interatomic potentials, one has to do this kind of a calculation and figure out that in the space of the nuclear configurations, what when you solve the electronic problem, what energies do you get? Okay, so people like Srikant and Balasubramaniam in CPMU, they work with these effective interatomic potentials for which a microscopic justification can be given through quantum chemistry. Okay, so is this point clear to all of you? Where does this interatomic potential come from?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if it is not clear to anyone, just let me know. Okay, yeah. All right. So the question that I can ask is, when do you think this Born-Oppenheimer approximation will break down? So when will the Born-Oppenheimer approximation? Yeah.
Sir, I have a question in the previous part.
Yeah, tell me. Yes,
sir,
ask.
You told that we will get a potential energy surface.
Yes. That's right.
But how is that? But how we will get that? We will get the total energy.
Okay, yeah, let me write down the equation and that will make it clear. Okay, so H electronic of the R psi electronic of the R is equal to E electronic of R and psi electronic of R where these R's are the nuclear positions. So what do we mean here? Okay, see, the electrons are moving in a rigid background of the nuclei. Okay, but the nuclei are placed in certain positions.
Okay.
Those positions are the nuclear positions, fine. And when we say this, then you need to imagine, I mean, you could imagine, for example, a perfect hexagonal benzene molecule or something which is distorted like this, for example. This gives you two different possible configurations of the nuclei, right? But there could be infinite number of such nuclear positions, correct?
Yeah.
Because you can move each atom, right? See, for example, this atom, you can move in three dimensions. So this itself has 3 degrees of freedom. This has 3 degrees of freedom. The hydrogen has 3 degrees of freedom. So in fact, you have 12 into 3, 36 degrees of freedom. But each degree of freedom is continuous. So in fact, you could have infinite number of nuclear positions. But what people do in practice is that they take a hyperdimensional grid, okay, in real space. For each atom, you build a grid and then you move each atom by a certain small amount, let's say by 1 picometer. Okay, and by moving each atom by 1 picometer, you get a new configuration. Okay, and for that configuration, you solve the electronic problem, the full Schrodinger's equation for the electronic problem, where the R's, the nuclear positions, are not variables, they are fixed. They are frozen, they are rigid. Okay, these R's could either correspond to this, or they could correspond to this, or some other configuration. It depends on how much computational power you have. You could consider 1,000 nuclear positions, you could consider 10,000, you could consider 1,000,000, 1,000,000,000, depending on how many times you can solve the electronic Schrodinger's equation. But once you solve it, you will get the E electronic as a function of R. This is a number. But this number depends on what are the nuclear positions. Okay. So for each set of nuclear positions, you will get a new E electron. And remember, we had taken the decoupling of the full wave function into the electron and the nuclei. So when you solve the new electronic problem, this happens even in the hydrogen atom. Okay, in the hydrogen atom also, you can decouple the different degrees of freedom, the R and the theta phi. Okay, in quantum mechanics, you have seen that, right?
Yeah.
So then what happens is, in the nuclear Schrodinger's equation, this is what enters as the potential. Okay, in the full Schrodinger's equation, when you substitute this, and you have already solved this by taking this approximation, then what appears in the sign nuclei, in the Schrodinger's equation for the nuclear degrees of freedom, is the potential given by the electronic energy eigenvalues. Okay, now what you see here is that the R itself, let's say even for benzene atom, you have R1, R2, so on up to R12. Okay, and each R is 3 degrees of freedom. So this is a 36 dimensional space. Okay, and in this 36 dimensional space, for each point, okay, see, when we say 3 dimensional space, each point you have a potential, you can actually draw a potential energy surface, right? Or constant potential surfaces. Like this, in the same way, in this 36 dimensional space, for each point in that space, you will get a E electronic of R. That is what we are calling a potential energy surface. Now, is this step clear? How do you get the potential energy surface? And why does it enter the nuclear problem?
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. But this is the total energy or only the potential energy?
Only the interatomic potential energy. This is not the total energy. Remember, the nuclear problem is still not solved, right? See, remember,
sir,
that,
Sir, in that, In that problem, there is a particular nuclear position and we are back in the electronic position and we are getting eigenvalue which will be the electronic and nuclear interaction potential. So
that's correct.
When we do the phonon expansion or something like that, then we will vary the happy color. And for this problem, we have to again solve the electronic energy for a different. Then
okay, no, I will come back to that. I will come back to that. That is not required. That is why I am saying. So just give me a moment, okay? So your question is extremely valid, but I'll come back to that. What I'm trying to tell here is that when you apply the, I'll come back to that. So when you apply the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, you can separate out the wave function or write the wave function in a separable form. That is the psi electrons and the psi nuclei. And you solve the psi electron problem taking different configurations of the nuclei. Once you solve this once you solve the electronic problem taking different positions of the nuclei, remember you're solving the electronic problem exactly. Okay, but the entire problem is not being solved exactly. Okay, the electronic problem taking fixed positions of the nuclei is being solved exactly using the many particle Schrodinger's equation. Okay, but once you solve that, then what you get is a E electronic, which is a function of what was the nuclear positions you had assumed, which means for every assumption of the nuclear positions, you will get a new number E electron of R. Right, and that is a potential energy surface in the 36 dimensional space of the nuclear degrees of freedom. This is specifically for benzene I'm talking about. Okay, this is only for C6H6. But now imagine that you have a crystal. Okay, in a crystal obviously you will have a lot more degrees of freedom and so on. So calculating the interatomic potential for a crystal is again not an easy job. Okay, there again one has to use completely new techniques, but there is a version of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation for crystals also. So Sukrishna Kanaya, is this was my answer clear?
Yes sir.
Yeah, what should I call you?
Krishna
or Kanaya? Huh?
Anything you prefer.
Anything, is it? Okay, fine. So I'll call you Krishna then. So was that Shovik who asked that other question?
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, see, I'm doing voice recognition now. Yeah, I'm good at voice recognition. I'm getting good at voice recognition. So more people should ask questions, okay? Okay, so Shovik, what your question, if I may rephrase, what you are asking is that we are solving the electronic problem given different configurations of the nuclei, correct? And once we solve that, if we go back to the nuclear problem and then give dynamics to the nuclei saying that there are phonon modes, there are lattice vibrations, so don't we have to solve the electronic problem once again because we are considering the dynamics of the nuclei? Is that the question?
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay, so
maybe there is some approximation also there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we don't have to do that. And the reason is that, remember, this E electronic of R that has been calculated has been calculated for all possible positions of the nuclei. Okay, this E electronic of R includes the harmonic term, anharmonic terms, and many orders of anharmonic terms. It's a full potential energy surface. Okay, this includes, for example, the displacement from equilibrium, which could be almost equal to the lattice parameter itself. Okay, so this has to be a all-inclusive interatomic potential. Now the question is that when you give dynamics to the nuclei, what are the electrons doing? Okay, and the answer to that, again, from the Born-Oppenheimer approximation or from the philosophy of this approximation, is that when the nuclei are moving, okay, it's as if for the electrons, they are not moving, in the sense that these electrons, they equilibrate to the instantaneous nuclear positions in almost no time. So what we mean by that is, if you look at it, if you look at the time scales of the problem, the nuclear time scales could be of the order of millisecond to microseconds. But if you look at the time scales of the electrons, they could be of the order of femtoseconds, okay, or tens or hundreds of femtoseconds. So you can see that like if the nucleus, if one of the nuclei makes one move, right, in that particular move over 1 microsecond or even 1 nanosecond, right, there could how many times the electrons would have moved, okay, if the time scale is of the order of femtoseconds for electrons. So electrons,
many times, thousand times.
Yeah, so electrons as a subsystem would equilibrate to the instantaneous positions of the nuclear of the nuclei, okay, and as soon as they equilibrate, you get a new potential energy. You understand? So by equilibrating to the instantaneous positions of the nuclei, they are creating the new interatomic potential, which is what you had calculated earlier. Okay, this is also known, so the Born-Oppenheimer approximation is also known as the adiabatic approximation, for the same reason that the electrons are adiabatically following the motion of the nuclei. Okay, so does this make
sir,
it clear?
Yes, sir. I have another question. The motion of electrons depends only on the mass of electrons or effective mass of electrons?
Excellent question. So, look, what we have to do is, we have to solve the electronic problem. Okay? Correct? And we are solving the full problem, which means we are taking the full Schrodinger's equation and we are solving it. Isn't that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, tell me, when does the effective mass picture apply? Whatever you know.
When we have
various situations, there are various situations in which the effective mass picture applies. But what do you think? Where does the effective mass, I mean, where does it come from and where does it apply?
When we get the result and know the effect of electrons from the dense structure of electrons,
exactly.
Then we need
correct. So the effective mass comes from, as you are saying, band theory, correct? Now where does band theory come from? Comes from Bloch's theorem.
Electron Bloch's theorem, and this is the basically we are going from this direction.
Correct. Now Bloch's theorem, okay, for getting the Bloch's theorem, you're solving a single electron picture, single electron moving in a perfectly periodic potential. Correct? Isn't this correct? You are moving the single electron in a perfectly periodic potential.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what you then do is, you assume that the crystal nuclei are perfectly periodic. Okay. They give you a perfectly periodic potential, which means they are also rigid. They are not moving about their equilibrium positions.
No vibrations.
Then, using that picture, you use the Bloch's theorem, and then you get a band theory, and from the band theory, you derive an effective mass. Correct? But this is not the solution of the full electron problem, because in the full electron problem you have to overcome this, because it's not a single electron picture, it's a multi-electron picture where the electrons are interacting with each other very strongly. The Bloch's theorem doesn't apply because it may not be periodic. When you move the nuclear positions about their equilibrium positions, right, and not dynamically, you know, in a frozen way, right, you change the molecular configuration or the crystal configuration, right, but then the potential is not periodic, so you can't apply Bloch's theorem, which means you don't have band theory, which means you don't have an effective mass picture. Okay, see, the effective mass picture is only applicable in a very restrictive situation, where you assume that phonons are not important, lattice vibrations are not important, you are dealing with a perfect crystal at extremely low temperatures, and the electrons are not interacting with each other, right? So that is what determines the effective mass picture. Okay, but here we are not doing that. For calculating this interatomic potential, you have to solve the full electron problem in the space of the nuclear positions, which need not be periodic. Does that clarify your?
I understand.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Yes, sir. Okay. But in this slide, you asked a question. When will the bond Oppenheimer approximation will break down?
Correct.
So if the motion of nucleus and electrons are comparable, then it will break down. Then how we can increase the motion or decrease the motion of electrons? If it depends on only mass of the electron, no effective mass.
Okay. So the point that you are trying to make is that, let's say, the bare masses of the electron, the nuclei, are never going to be equal. So the only way they could be equal is that if the effective mass of the electrons becomes very large, right? And that is when it becomes comparable to the nuclei, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So it turns out, if you look up the band masses of these electrons, then the band masses of these electrons are not very large. In fact, the band masses could even be less than 1. So the electrons could even become lighter. Okay. And don't tell me about Dirac massless electrons, because those massless fermions are not the effective mass, right? They are effective masses. These massless Dirac fermions are massless because of a different reason. So let's not consider that. But if you look at semiconductors like gallium arsenide or germanium, you can get effective masses which are actually smaller than 1. So the effective mass picture, as you are mentioning, in normal crystals with a single electron picture, does not lead to a breakdown of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. Okay?
Sir. I don't know the exact reason, but while I was studying the scope, when two potential converges, the approximation of the exact.
Exactly, when they intersect.
Oh, yes, sir. But this is the case.
Correct. So, see, what is happening there is that there is a adiabatic to a dibatic transition. So, this is something that is not within the scope of this course, but basically what is happening there is that if there are configurations where two potential energy surfaces could, for example, cross each other, and there is a degeneracy point in the space of the nuclear positions. Okay, so at this particular point, it turns out that the Born-Oppenheimer approximation is not really valid, is invalid. And the reason this becomes invalid is that this is some kind of a quantum critical point of the level crossing kind. Okay, see, what is happening here is that if you think about this, this is the electronic potential energy surface. This is also an electronic potential energy surface, and they are becoming degenerate at some particular configuration of the nuclei. So there is a sort of a level crossing that is happening here. And when there is a level crossing, it turns out that if the electrons are in this configuration to begin with, right, and you are moving the nuclei towards this level crossing position, then the electrons will not actually follow this. Okay, some of the electrons will come here and some electrons will go here, and which means that the electrons are not adiabatically following the electronic energy, the potential energy surface. Okay, there is going to be something called a defect production. So this is a very interesting topic, but unfortunately this is completely out of scope of this syllabus. But you can look up something, if you're interested, you can look up defect production across quantum critical points. And it turns out this is so important that this is also related to the Big Bang itself, okay, the birth of the universe, and how the universe, how the forces, or how there is a spontaneous symmetry breaking, and so on and so forth. So this is a extremely important topic, and it is important across all scales, starting from the universal astrophysical scales all the way down to the molecular scales. Okay, so excellent point. So thanks for that. And this is where this Born-Oppenheimer approximation could break down. Okay, there are other situations also that you can read about. Okay, but let me not go into that. But in most situations, okay, you could see that you can see that this is going to be an excellent approximation, and you can use this approximation to study the electronic problem and the nuclear problem separately, okay, which is what we do when we do band theory. So as I was explaining, in band theory, we ignore the motion of the crystal atoms, we place them in rigid periodic positions, and we look at one electron moving through this periodic potential, and then look at what are the energy levels of that electron. Now, that can be made more complicated by adding more electrons to the system and then making them interacting, okay? And then you can make it even more complicated by saying, okay, the electrons, there are many electrons which are interacting with each other, but now the crystal atoms are not placed at periodic positions, they are moving about their equilibrium positions. So that is called phonons, that is called lattice vibrations, right? And that is what we are going to study in this unit, right? But without invoking the electrons. So we have thrown the electrons out of the picture by solving their problem, getting an interatomic potential surface, interatomic potential energy surface, and then expanding it about the equilibrium positions, okay, the global, finding the global minimum of that potential energy surface, then expanding the full function about that equilibrium position, and then looking at the harmonic term, the second order term, right? So that is where we are at right now. So let me now consider a very simple situation of a 1D monoatomic Brevi lattice. So after all this, we are coming back to a very simple problem. And we are doing this because I was told by somebody that in the solid state physics course that they had in the last semester, they could not do this properly, because, and so that is why I'm reviewing this once again. Okay, so a monoatomic 1D lattice. So let's consider this, and remember, no electrons. Okay, so it's purely atoms placed like this, and there is some sort of a interatomic potential between these. Okay, so the potential energy of this whole thing is given by half k sum over n u of n a minus u of n plus 1 into n whole square. So what did I do here? I said the potential energy is basically given by half kx squared, okay? But this x, what is this x here? This x is basically the distance between any two neighboring atoms. So only nearest neighbors are connected by springs. That is the model of a 1D crystal. So in this case, if this has moved to, let's say, this new position, and this has moved to this new position, then this distance here represents this. Okay, this is what is represented by UNA, which is the displacement from equilibrium of the nth atom. This is the displacement from equilibrium of the n plus 1th atom, and the difference between those two is what is written here. Okay, this is not exactly this distance, this is actually the displacement from equilibrium of the two respective nuclei. Okay, so that's a little bit more subtle, and it's harder to visualize than this. All right. So this k, remember, is coming from the second derivative of the interatomic potential of v of ri minus rj. So given this, now we want to ask, what is the dynamics of this chain? And as a first approximation, let's look at the classical dynamics. Let's not treat the nuclei as if they are quantum mechanical. Okay, and that's a very good approximation, it turns out. So if I want to treat this classically, which equations should I use? Can somebody tell me what equations should I use for describing
Newton's equation, second law?
Newton's equations, right? Very good. So I will use Newton's equations. And for Newton's equations, what I need is m times xn double dot, right? This m is the nuclear mass, is equal to the force on the nth atom, okay? But this force is basically given by del v by del xn, okay? So this can be changed into m un double dot v by del un, Okay. Now, if you take this equation and apply it to this problem, right, this internal atomic potential, you can very easily write down what is the equation of motion. Okay. So, let me see. I think I had written it down. Yeah, that's right. So the m times u n double dot is given by minus k times u n 2 minus u n minus 1 minus u n plus 1. So this is very simple to understand, right? That the restoring force on the nth atom is just minus kx. And then since the nth atom is also connected to the n minus 1 and the n plus 1, their displacements also enter the equation of motion of the nth atom, right? Now, suppose I consider 1, 2, 3, so on up to n atoms, okay? And then I consider periodic boundary conditions. Just give me 1 minute. Actually, there is some disturbance in the neighboring room. I'll just request them to keep it a little bit low. Okay, just give me 1 minute. All right, so so the equation of motion for the nth atom is this. And what I want to ask you is, suppose I take periodic boundary conditions, then with periodic boundary conditions, I'm basically solving the problem of a ring, right? So the first atom is here and the nth atom is here, but n plus 1th atom is the same as the first atom. All right, so this is the problem that I'm trying to solve. Now, can somebody tell me how many equations like this would be there? How many equations do I have to solve? Can you all hear me?
All the atoms are identical.
Yes.
So I think one will be enough.
So if you take only one equation, then don't you think it is coupled to the un minus 1 and un plus 1?
Yes,
and
it
remember,
is.
Remember, this is a second derivative in time, right?
Yes.
So this is d2 un by dt squared, isn't it? So, and this will be dependent on time. So in time, the un could be very different from un minus 1 and un plus 1.
Yes.
Is it
yes.
not? So then how would you hope to solve this equation if you don't know the dependence on time of un minus 1 and un plus 1? You need to know that, right?
Yes.
If you want to solve this equation, you need to know how does un minus 1 depend on time and how does un plus 1 depend on time. So
yes,
then
yes.
Can you tell me how many equations? Guess? So the total number of atoms in this system is capital N.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So don't we have to write an equation for each atom in the system? And each atom in the system is connected by springs to its neighboring atom. Right?
Yes.
So yeah, what we will get is basically a set of coupled differential equations for each atom in the lattice. So 2u1 minus un minus 1 will be, remember when I go from 1 to 0, 1 minus 1 is 0, but 0 is basically cap because this is a ring, right? And then this will be u2. Similarly, I will write another equation for u2 double dot. You get 2u2 minus u, and then this will become 2 minus 1, 1, and this will become u3. So like this, there will be n coupled second order differential equation. Do you agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. So there are many ways to solve this problem. Okay. So let me give you one possible, and the reason I'm considering how many equations and so on, you might not realize the importance of this right away, but this is deeply connected to how many normal modes there will be in this system. Okay. And what are normal modes and what are phonons and so on, that is also intimately connected to this question. So let's just spend a few minutes on the structure of these equations, because these equations will tell you how many normal modes exist in this system. Okay, so let's just write this one equation once again. So what we are saying is that M U N double dot, or let's say U one double dot, is given by minus K times U one to U one minus U N minus U two. Similarly, M U two double dot is given by minus K to U two double dot is given by minus U two minus U three minus U one and so on. Okay, so to solve this set of differential equations, what one can do is to take some form of U one U two. Okay, but more importantly, what we are going to do now is to assume some sort of a harmonic approximation, which means let's take the ui to be equal to some ui tilde, let's say, times e to the power I omega t. Okay, so we are assuming that all the different atoms in the system are vibrating according to some frequency omega. This is very important. Okay, every single atom in the system is being assumed to vibrate with the same frequency omega, right? But the spatial dependence could be different. Okay, this is, remember, just the spatial index, and this is the time dependence, and we are separating out the space dependence and the time dependence. Now, as soon as we do this, right, then this equation, this set of equations, can be written in a matrix form. Okay, and what does that matrix look like? Let us see, right? So if I substitute this I omega t into this, I will get a minus m omega squared. Okay, and that minus m omega squared e to the power I omega t, that e to the power I omega t will cancel from here, 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 right? So I will be left with similar kind of equations, but they will be algebraic equations, that is minus m omega squared u1 tilde is equal to minus k to u1 tilde minus un tilde minus u2 tilde and so on. Minus m omega squared u2 tilde is given by minus k to u2 tilde minus u1 tilde minus u3 tilde and so on. So now we get a series of n linear equations, right? And we have to solve these. So this is a set of n linear equations, but that is very easy to solve, right? But look at the structure of these linear equations. Okay, remember, you have all the ui's and there is no constant term. If there is no constant term, then the structure of this matrix, if I write the structure of this matrix and if I write the variables, it will be u1 tilde, u2 tilde, so on up to un tilde, okay, equal to 0. And what will be the structure here? So I can take the m omega squared on that side, so I will get an m omega squared minus 2k here. Okay, and the u1 tilde connects to the u2 tilde as well as the un tilde, so I will get here a k times just a k, and here also I will get a k and zeros everywhere. So I suggest that some of you try this out. Okay, those who are theoretically inclined, please try this out. It's a very simple problem and it's very instructive also, because you can actually solve the normal modes of a one-dimensional coupled harmonic oscillator problem. Okay, so what you can see from here is that there are only three non-zero elements in one row of this matrix, and the second row again will have a k here. and this will be m omega squared minus 2k 0 0 0 0 and so on, okay, and then there will be a k here also. So what you can see is that this is a tri-banded matrix, okay, with a k here and a k here. But what is more interesting is that there is a zero on the right hand side. So what is this system of equations called? So this is a homogeneous system of equations. Okay. And when does a solution to this system of equations exist? Only when this matrix is singular. Okay. So this matrix is singular means that the determinant of that matrix, let's call it some H matrix, is zero. Okay. But if you substitute the determinant matrix of, the determinant of this to be zero, then you will get a polynomial. Okay. This results in a polynomial of order n in the variable omega squared. Okay. So this, the solution of this matrix, or the determinant equal to zero of this matrix, gives you a polynomial of the order of n, which is in omega squared, right? So which means you will get n roots. And if you have n roots, these are the normal modes of the system. Okay. So again, what are we doing here? We are saying we are taking a particular ansatz for the solution of these coupled differential equations. The ansatz is that all the atoms in this system, in this 1D system, are vibrating with the same frequency, omega. Okay, the frequency is exactly the same for all the atoms, right? And but the displacements could be different. The amplitudes could be different. Okay, so taking that, and that's when we substitute in this, we get n different possible solutions. Okay, and each solution is called a normal mode of the system, and a normal mode is nothing but the characteristic frequency of that particular system. So if I take a simple pendulum, for example, then when I perturb it about its equilibrium position, I know that there is a particular time period, okay, 2 pi root L by G. Okay, this defines a certain frequency, and that is the normal mode of this particular system. Again, if I now take a coupled oscillator system, I couple these oscillators, okay, I will get two characteristic frequencies, right? Similarly, if I take three atoms, I'll get three characteristic frequencies. So if I take n atoms, I should get n characteristic frequencies. Okay, and this has been illustrated very nicely in a certain video. So let me just show you that video. I have that in the presentation slide. Let me go back to that. Can all of you see the screen?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. So you see here, this is an animation which is showing the first six normal modes of a 1D lattice. We have not fully solved for the normal modes. Okay. I just told you how normal modes can arise as the solution of a characteristic equation of a matrix, right? But if you look at what different frequencies are possible, or what are the eigenvalues of that, what are the roots of that equation, then it turns out to be of this form, right? 0.52 omega, 1 omega, 1.41 omega, 1.73, 1.93 and 2. And for these frequencies, remember the ui tilde were different. So each atom has a different amplitude. Okay. So you can see that this is one. Normal modes represents a characteristic frequency with which the entire crystal can vibrate simultaneously. Okay, and this is true not only for 1D, it's also true for 3D or any D that you will have normal modes corresponding to a coupled harmonic oscillator system. And visualizing those normal modes is extremely important. Okay, in fact, if you look at molecules, then there are certain modes that are Raman active, that are not Raman active, that are infrared active, and things like that. And identifying those modes in spectroscopy becomes extremely important. Okay, in fact, identifying these modes even in bulk systems like crystal lattices is also very important, because some of these can couple to or can lead to attractive interaction between electrons and give you superconductivity. Some of these are responsible for electron phonon interaction. Some of these are responsible for Yan-Teller distortion. Okay, so identifying these normal modes is an extremely important job. And in fact, many structural transitions are led by softening of the phonons. So when we say there is a structural transition, then we are saying that the interatomic potential, which is giving you the global minimum, is actually becoming a global or a local maximum. And with let's say pressure or doping or temperature, that interatomic potential is no longer a minimum. Okay, it could have become a saddle point, or it could have become a maximum, right? So that is the point at which some of these normal modes become soft. Okay, which means their frequency goes to zero. So identifying those normal modes which are going soft becomes extremely important to understand phase transitions, especially structural phase transitions. And these days there is a question about many electronic phase transitions also. So if there is a certain system which is going through a metal insulator transition, we want to understand whether the phonons are driving the electrons or the electrons are driving the phonons. Okay, and in order to do that, we again need to understand which is the precursor. Right, we need to understand the physics of this, the electron phonon coupling and the enharmonicity and many other things, electron electron interaction and so on. Okay, so this is the normal modes of a 1D system, but let me take you to a simpler system. Okay, so this simpler system is again a finite number of atoms. So this video starts with just 3 atoms. Okay, so you see these 3 atoms are fixed here, and then these are the 3 possible normal modes. Okay, all of them are moving in phase, then the 2 outside are moving out of phase, and the inner one is stationary, and then here all 3 are out of phase. Okay, so here again there are 4 atoms and these are the 4 possible normal modes. So this is all in phase and then out of phase and so on and so forth. Okay, and finally he considers 5 atoms and shows the 5 normal modes of the 5 atoms. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
So electron is a particle, yes, which is a spin up particle, and this phonon mode, right?
That's correct. But did we discuss that?
Okay. No. Actually, I'm just wondering if they are actually different, how come they don't move together?
No. Wait. So let's go back one. Let's go back. A little bit. So when I took the model of a coupled harmonic oscillator, did I say that it was a quantum mechanical model?
No.
Yes?
No.
No, right? I didn't say that it was a quantum mechanical model. In fact, when I asked you for the solution of the classical dynamics, then Krishna Kanaya said that we can take, or somebody said that we can take Newton's equations. Correct?
Yes.
And by solving the Newton's equations, we have got the n roots of this particular characteristic polynomial, and that is what is giving us the normal modes. So,
okay,
is there a question, I mean, where does the question of the phonons being bosons arise in this whole treatment? Did it arise?
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't arise, right? So, in fact, it turns out a classical treatment of phonons is good to a very large extent. In most treatments of the phonons, treating phonons as classical is not a bad approximation at all. Okay, and the point where phonons also need to be made quantum mechanical is when you consider electron phonon interaction or phonon phonon interaction. Okay, so when you consider anharmonicity, then it turns out that the way phonons interact with each other, if you don't consider them quantum mechanically, then you will not get the right answer. That is the first situation. But you also know that if I now take the solution of this equation and then treat the or then find the partition function of this system, okay, and treat the degrees of freedom, which is the U case, as classical degrees of freedom, I will get a specific heat which is completely wrong. I will get a equipartition theorem and that will give me a constant specific heat 3 by 2 R. Correct? I mean, in this case, it's 1D, so it's just half R. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Right? So, considering them as quantum mechanical modes is important in certain situations. But if you're looking at dynamics, for example, if you're looking at just finding what is the dispersion, if you're looking at the neutron spectroscopy and then using the using neutron scattering to find the phonon dispersions and so on, you can treat the phonons as completely classical by looking at the harmonic approximation. Okay, so the point at which phonons become bosons, okay, that I'm not sure if we can treat that in this course, but the way to look at it is the following. If you look at the simple harmonic oscillator in the in quantum mechanics and you look at the A and A dagger operators, okay, those A and A dagger operators will turn out to have bosonic commutation relations. Okay, so that's how you can show that these normal modes, when you describe them as creation annihilation operators, then those operators have a bosonic form. So that's how we say that they are bosons. Now, what was your question exactly?
Like if phonons are bosons, electrons are fermions.
Yes.
How can they do partition, especially how? When they are
moving? Good. Okay. So again, going back to the classical picture itself, you can see that how they will interact, and then we will come back to how they interact quantum mechanically. Okay. So classically itself, you can see that if an electron is scattering against an ion, okay, a nucleus, right, then it's going to get scattered in some different momentum position, in some different momentum state, and maybe in some different energy state also. Okay, so there are two possibilities. One is that there is pure elastic scattering, which is coherent and maintains the phase of the electronic wave function, but there could also be an inelastic scattering, which involves a change of energy of the electron. Okay, so if you consider a purely rigid crystal where the nuclei are not moving, then the scattering from these completely periodic positions of the crystal nuclei is a pure coherent scattering, which allows you to do a wave treatment for the electrons and gives you the Bloch's theorem. Okay, but if you bring in phonons, that is the motion of the nuclei about their equilibrium positions, then the scattering of the electron against these moving nuclei is not a elastic scattering, it's inelastic scattering. Electron phonon scattering is inelastic. Your question is, how can it be that one is an electron and one is a boson, and how do they interact with each other? Okay, and that interaction is purely Coulombic. See, remember, when the nuclei is moving, when the nucleus is moving, the electron is going to feel a potential which is not the same throughout its motion. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Okay, so the interaction which gives rise to the electron phonon interaction is again Coulombic in nature. It's nothing else. Okay, but now when you quantize it, yeah, go on.
Yes, I'm saying like that interaction is not momentum interaction.
There is momentum conservation. So in quantum mechanical terms, the thing looks like this. Okay, there is a CK, there is a CK dagger, okay, and then there is a phonon momentum. So let's say this is K and this is K plus Q, and there is a AQ that is involved, okay, so which is getting destroyed. So there is a phonon which is getting absorbed, and the electron is scattering off the phonon with a momentum K and then getting out with a momentum K plus Q. Okay, so these kind of electron phonon terms can be written, and is again a topic in the advanced solid state physics course, but this is how the electron phonon interaction looks like. Okay, so one can write hybrid terms, hybrid Hamiltonians, which have both electrons and bosons, and the electrons and bosons interact with each other. In fact, similar thing would happen when you consider photon electron interactions or light matter interactions. Okay, so but again, this kind of a formalism is beyond the scope of this course. Does that clarify things?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So yeah, so this is basically the essence of the normal modes, that you solve n coupled differential equations, and when you solve these n coupled differential equations by going to the time space, by removing the time, by using a harmonic approximation, by using this plane wave approximation, then what you get are these n coupled linear equations. But these are homogeneous linear equations, so when you solve them, you have to say that for a non-trivial solution, this matrix has to be singular, which means that the determinant has to be zero, which means there are n possible roots for the omega, right, for the omega squared, and those n roots are the normal modes. And by construction, you can see that omega squared has to be positive. Okay, so you have to consider only those normal modes for which omega squared is positive and real. Any omega squared that you get as negative or imaginary have to be thrown out. Those normal modes are not allowed in reality. Okay, so yeah, with this I will just stop here, and tomorrow we will start with we can do a quantum mechanical treatment of the whole thing, and we will also do a diatomic basis and see how many normal modes there are in a monatomic lattice with a in a 1D lattice with the basis of two atoms or multiple atoms. Okay, and then we will generalize that, and then go on to some thermal properties and so on. So that's where we will stop here. If there are more questions, I can take them.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, my internet was lost for last 2 minutes. So can you please say that what you said before?
Oh my God! Okay, there was why aren't there electrons?
I had the question that electron is fermion and phonon is boson. So how they can interact? And you answered it. It is purely Coulombic. So after that, I could not get you. So after that statement, what you said? What you said?
When you write the full Coulombic interactions, you can do a quantization of that Hamiltonian, and when you do a quantization of that Hamiltonian, you can write down electron phonon interactions. Okay, and in diagrammatic terms, they goes out. Okay, but that phonon could be either absorbed or emitted. So this is the emission of a phonon, and this is the absorption of a phonon. Okay, and the phonon is represented by bosonic operators, and the electron is represented by electronic operators. So where this is C, CK plus Q, so basically these operators have anti-commutation relations. Okay, whereas these operators, the AQ operators, they have bosonic commutation relations. So this is a commutator and this is an anti-commutator. Okay, and this particular process, this particular scattering process, represents the emission of a phonon, and this represents the absorption of a phonon. Okay, so this is all I was saying. And I also said treating this kind of quantum mechanical interaction is not within the scope of this course. That's all. We could do this in the advanced solid state, where we introduce this second quantization and these operators and so on. Okay, so there are few more questions on this. Why aren't there electron interactions in the Hamiltonian? So electron interactions were there. So Siam, the electron interactions were there. But what I said is that when you solve the full electron problem, then you get the e electron as a function of the nuclear positions Ri. Okay, and that is what you consider when you consider the crystal problem where, or the phonon problem. Okay, and yeah, this we have already. So Meghna, what do you mean by conical intersections? Okay, maybe she has signed out. So yeah, I don't completely understand what.
When we are considering all those configurations of atoms.
Mm-hmm.
So all the configurations will be of different probabilities.
That's correct.
So the probability of having a particular configuration won't be same.
Okay, fine.
So how can we take those?
No, we are not. Okay, good. So we are not building a statistical mechanical ensemble. Okay, what we are doing is that we are basically building a potential energy surface. We are saying that you give me a set of positions Ri. They might not have the same probability at all. In fact, some of those positions might be totally improbable.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
What this particular thing will do is that it will give you a zero temperature picture of what would be the energy, potential energy corresponding to those configurations. So imagine again the benzene, and imagine a particular configuration which looks like this. Possible configuration where I have stretched this molecule so much that this has come all the way inward and it is sitting almost like a rectangle. It's possible, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. But when you calculate the electronic energy corresponding to this particular positions, you will find that it is huge. And the global minimum would be somewhere here in that 36 dimensional space. Remember.
Okay.
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 So basically you can find out the electronic energies for any given position, for any given configuration of the nuclei, and you will find that those which are improbable have a very, very high energy. So the system will never occupy them.
Okay.
Unless you perturb the system so much or you kick the system so hard using either a, you know, impulse or some other kind of thing, using a photon, that the crystal can take those positions also. Okay, unless that happens, the system will never go to that configuration. But we are not talking about the probabilities of those configurations at all. That probability will then be determined by in equilibrium e to the power minus beta e electron of r.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
This would be the probability.
Yes.
And
yes.
If this is very, very large, then this probability will become extremely small. So ideally, one would consider the density matrix. And then the density matrix would give you the probabilities of each configuration. And that is valid even in non-equilibrium. Okay.
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 All right. So let's meet tomorrow then at 4 p.m.